morning and a warm welcome to our Stewardship Sunday worship service. Let us begin our worship in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Shall we sing to the glory of God the hymn, "Ye servants of God, your Master proclaim"? Let us invoke God's blessings. Almighty God, in Jesus Christ, you open for us a new and living way into your presence. As we worship you, bless our Stewardship Sunday worship service. Give us pure hearts and constant wills to be good steward, transparent and accountable, to worship you in truth and spirit through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Now let us enter into the act of confession.
Confession. The proof of God's amazing love is this: while we were sinners, Christ died for us. Because we have faith in him, we dare to approach God with confidence. In faith and penitence, let us confess our sins before God and one another. Let us all together confess our sins, following the corporate prayer of confession. Merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. Though you have entrusted with your resources, we are not transparent and accountable. We have not loved you with our whole heart and mind and strength. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us amend what we are and direct what we shall be, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, and to the glory of your holy name. Amen. absolution. Hear the good news. The saying is sure and worthy of full acceptance that Christ Jesus came to the world to save sinners. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross that we might be dead to sin and alive to all that is good. Gracious God, who has revealed compassion and fullness of life through your Son Jesus Christ and called us to be responsible with the resources available, grant that we may be prudent in the management of resources as people who fear God, trustworthy and who hate dishonest gain, so that in overflowing joy and rich generosity, we may be wise stewards of God's manifold gifts through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Thanks be to God. Today is observed as Stewardship Sunday. The theme for our meditation is Stewardship, Transparency and Accountability. Let us all in unison say together the collect for this week. God, the source of all resources, we realize that you have bestowed upon us every visible and invisible resource, expecting it to be made use for the extension of your kingdom. Help us to be grateful to you for the confidence and trust you have conferred on us in doing so. Grant us the strength to fulfill the duty of stewardship in utilizing the resources of that you have entrusted upon us to care for others, that this trust may bear fruits. We pray that we will be blessed with multiples of resources. This we ask in the name of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Now we shall have the scripture reading, beginning with Old Testament, followed by Epistle reading.
Today's Old Testament reading is taken from the book of Exodus, chapter 36. Verses 2 to 7, Exodus chapter 36, beginning to read from verse 2. And Moses called Bezalel and Oholiab, and every craftsman in those mine the Lord had put skill, everyone whose heart stirred up to come to do the work. And they received from Moses all the contribution that the people of Israel had brought for doing the work on the sanctuary. They still kept bringing him freewill offering every morning, so that all the craftsmen who were doing every sort of task on the sanctuary came, each from the task that he was doing, and said to Moses, "The people bringing much more than enough for doing the work that the Lord has commanded us to do." So Moses gave command, and the word was proclaimed throughout the camp, "Let no man or woman do anything more for the contribution for the sanctuary." So the people were restrained from bringing for the material they had sufficient to do all the work and more. Here ends the reading. Thanks be to thee, O God.
The epistle reading is taken from Philippians chapter 4, verses beginning to read from 10 to 20. Philippians chapter 4, verses beginning to read from 10. God's provision. I rejoiced in the Lord greatly that now at length you have revived your concern for me. You were indeed concerned for me, but you had no opportunity. Not that I am speaking of being in need, for I have learned in whatever situation I am to be content. I know how to be brought low, and I know how to abound. In any and every circumstance, I have learned the secret of facing plenty and hunger, abundance and need. I can do all things through him who strengthens me. Yet it was kind of you to share my trouble. And you Philippians yourselves know that in the beginning of the gospel, when I left Macedonia, no church entered into partnership with me in giving and receiving except you only. Even in Thessalonica, you sent me help for my needs once and again. Not that I seek the gift, but I seek the fruit that increases to your credit. I have received full payment and more. I am well supplied, having received from Epaphroditus the gifts you sent, a fragrant offering, a sacrifice acceptable and pleasing to God. And my God will supply every need of yours according to his riches in glory in Christ Jesus. To our God and Father be glory forever and ever. Amen. Here ends the epistle reading. Thanks be to God.
Our gradual is, give of your best to the Master. Now, the gospel lesson would be read to us.
The gospel reading is taken from the gospel according to St. Luke, chapter 19, verses 11 to 27. The gospel according to St. Luke, chapter 19, verses 11 to 27. The parable of the 10 minas. As they heard these things, he proceeded to tell a parable, because he was near to Jerusalem, and because they supposed that the kingdom of God was to appear immediately. He said, therefore, a nobleman went into a far country to recover for himself a kingdom, and then return. Calling 10 of his servants, he gave them 10 minas and said to them, engage in business until I come. But his citizens hated him and sent a delegation after him, saying, we do not want this man to reign over us. When he returned, having received the kingdom, he ordered these servants to whom he had given the money to be called to him, that he might know what they had gained by doing business. The first came before him, saying, Lord, your mina has made 10 minas more. And he said to him, well done, good servant, because you have been faithful in a very little, you shall have authority over 10 cities. And the second one came, saying, Lord, your mina has made 5 minas. And he said to him, and you are to be over 5 cities. Then another came, saying, Lord, here is your mina, which I had kept away in a handkerchief, for I was afraid of you, because you are a severe man. You take what you did not deposit and reap what you did not sow. He said to him, I will condemn you with your own words, you wicked servant. You know that I was a severe man, taking what I did and not depositing and reaping what I do not sow. Why then did you not put my money in the bank? And at my coming, I might have collected it with interest. And he said to those who stood by, take the mina from him and give it to the one who has the 10 minas. And they said to him, Lord, he has 10 minas. I tell you that to everyone who has more will be given. But from the one who has not, even what he has will be taken away. But as for these enemies of mine who did not want me to reign over them, bring them here and slaughter them before me. Here ends the gospel reading. Thanks be to thee, O God.
The preacher for today is Reverend Christy Gnanadasan, newly appointed chairman for the Bangalore Civil Area Council. He is the presbyter in charge of St. Paul's Church next to Bowring Hospital. Reverend Christy Gnanadasan has served our diocese in various capacities, both in the rural as well as urban areas. He has been ushering many reforms in our diocese, and we look forward for his great ministry in our area and the diocese. On behalf of each one of you and the members of the pastorate committee, I extend a warm welcome to Reverend Christy Gnanadasan and request to him to bring us the word of God.
Dear friends, I greet you all in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I thank Reverend Vincent Vinod Kumar, the presbyter in charge of St. Mark's Church, for giving me an opportunity to be part of this worship online and also share the word of God on this day. Let us pray. Gracious, loving God, God of life and God of all new beginnings, we praise and thank you, Lord, for the gift of life that you have bestowed upon us. As we meditate upon your words, inspire us, O Lord, encourage us to be a transformative tools in this world. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable unto you, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Dear friends, I once again greet you all in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. The Church of South India celebrates this Sunday as Stewardship Sunday. And the theme given to us is Stewardship, transparency and accountability. Stewardship is one of the important gospel that is preached all over and also expected to be practiced all over. At times, stewardship is preached by the church, but seldom it practices stewardship. The book of Genesis brings out the beauty of the creation and also invites the humankind to be stewards of God's creation. In other words, God entrusted the resources to humankind and commissioned them to take care of these resources so that it could be handed over to generations and generations to fulfill God's purpose of life. Further, stewardship is also an invitation to work for a world of justice, which caters to the needs and well-being of the entire creation. With this background, while the humankind were called to be the caretakers of God's resources, the humankind, rather taking care of God's resources, they took over God's resources and claimed ownership on God's resources, denying the ownership of God. So it is in this juncture, the Stewardship Sunday is calling us to reimagine the very concept of stewardship, to rethink on the purpose that God handed over these resources to us, and to reiterate God as God of life for all. So the theme is encouraging us to envisage a new understanding of stewardship, from taking over of the creation to taking care of the creation. The passages that were read to us discloses the understanding of stewardship in different perspectives. Firstly, to begin with the Old Testament passage. The Old Testament passage unveils the liberality of a liberative community. I say the liberality of the liberative community because it speaks about the life world of Israelites. Israel was experiencing slavery in Egypt, and God intervened in their experience, liberates them, and takes them through the wilderness to reach the promised land, which is a land of peace and harmony. Israel was benefited by God's intervention in their life. God was present with them as a pillar of cloud in the day and as a pillar of fire in the night. Being the benefactors of God's presence in their journey of slavery and in their journey of wilderness, Israel wanted this God to be present among them in their life world. And thus, they wanted to build a tabernacle as an abode of God and wanted God to live amidst them, experiencing them, enriching them, and encouraging them to move forward in their life. So in a context as such, when people decided to build an abode for God, Moses gives an invitation for the people to come forward and contribute towards this purpose. And the result was enormous. People brought forth everything that they had in order to build a tabernacle and make sure that God dwells amidst them in their life world. And their participation and contribution was so much that Moses was forced to tell them, stop contributing towards this. What a great gospel it is to tell the community to stop contributing. We live in a context where we experience the dearth of people participating and contributing in the welfare of the others. But here, God being a source of life for the others, Israelites were very keen to have this God amidst them, and they wanted to contribute everything that they had towards building a tabernacle in order to have God amidst them, experiencing them and enlightening them with the values of gospel. So what is that which makes them so liberal where Moses is asking them to stop contributing? I personally feel that it was their experiences that made them so liberal. And what are the experiences that they underwent? Initially, to begin with, they experienced slavery in Egypt. Their life was threatened. They were scared every moment. So it could be called as a scarcity which threatened Israelites in Egypt. And God's intervention in such experience liberates them from the fear that was imposed upon them by the Egyptian slavery. And as they were liberated from this Egyptian slavery, they had to journey through wilderness. And in this journey, they experience scarcity. The Bible very clearly says that Israelites were grumbling for food and water. And it is in this experience of scarcity, God intervenes and meets them their need. So these experiences of being in a scarcity and also experiencing scarcity in wilderness, Israel molds the self in the very values of God. The value of God's generosity is experienced and also experimented in and through the life of Israel. Therefore, they were very liberal in contributing towards this purpose. So the stewards are those who experience slavery and scarcity. We are enslaved with many values, and we should understand that the gospel value is engaged in redeeming us, is engaged in redeeming us from these worldly values. And the gospel is also leading us through scarcity in order to meet the needs of the people. So stewards are those who experience fear and scarcity and are transformed into a generous community, being examples of God's generosity. Therefore, dear friends, firstly, to be called as stewards of God, we are called to be a community of liberality. a community that has experienced God's liberative purpose, and a community which is called to express God's love liberally to the world. So as stewards, we are called to be participating in God's mission liberally as a liberative community. Secondly, the epistle reading discloses the commitment or the contentment of a convinced community. The epistle reading discloses the contentment of a convinced community. Being convinced in a consumeristic world is a bigger task, because this consumeristic world is bringing forth newness every day in enticing people. And we succumb to this, and we have fallen trapped to the world of consumerism. Gone are the days where our parents used to earn a meager salary, and they used to meet the needs of the family, and also they were able to have something in store for the future. But the consumeristic world is forcing us to spend everything that we earn, and also this consumeristic world is forcing us into the world of credit. So no individual is content with what they have. No individual is content with what they have. They are urging for more and more. And the advertisements that we come across encourages us to go for something new every day. I want more. I want more. Give me more. Here we are reminded about what Moses said. It is enough. It is enough. So saying enough is a counter to a consumeristic world. Saying enough is Christian creed. Imagine the creed of Israelites emerges in wilderness, where they were wanting for the needs, not for the greed. So the creed of Israel emerges in need. However, today the creed has moved from the need to greed. So the Christian churches today are engaged in teaching prosperity theology, which is encouraging greed for anything and everything. Though the Bible makes it very clear, though the Bible categorically states that God is God of need, but churches are engaged in propagating God as God of greed. So we are not convinced with a theology, or we are not convinced with the gospel which says God meets the needs of the people. Rather, we think beyond the need, and we always portray God as a God who meets the greeds of the people. So it is in this context we are called to be content with what God has given us. So consumerism has become a culture in today's world. How could we counter this culture? The Bible teaches us we can counter this culture being convinced with the gospel of Jesus, and be content in what God has given us to pursue life. The Philippians text that was read to us, Paul emphatically states that I am convinced and I am content in what God has given me. I'm satisfied with what God has given me. Today, the consumeristic world says satisfaction is the death of development. Materialistic way. Satisfaction is the death of development in a materialistic way. You should not be satisfied with any material that you have. You should upgrade the materials that you have with you. And that's the reason the iPhone, which started with S4, has crossed S12. The one who was convinced with S4 is craving for S12 today. And this is in every aspect of life. So Paul very clearly states that I am convinced with what God has given me and I am content in it. And he is acknowledging the churches in being part of this mission of contentment, in being part of the mission to meet the needs of the people and satisfying people's need. Paul places himself as an example for this. So the churches are communities of stewards, which are called to engage in satisfying people, in making people content. But the extravagancy of church is leading people astray from this gospel. The church is asking more and more materialistically. The church is supposed to ask people to participate more and more in mission and ministry of the church. However, today we have come to a situation where ministry is impossible without material. We are called to materialize ministry, but material has become a source of ministry in today's world. So how do we counter this culture of consumerism? Through the epistle reading, we are reminded that church is a community of stewards, which is called to be convinced and also committed to convince the others in order to be content in what God has given us. Therefore, church should propagate the creed, which is basically built upon the needs of the people than the greeds of the people. Finally, the gospel text is disclosing the commitment of a commissioned community. Disciples were commissioned to bring forth an alternative world, countering the existing worldly values. In bringing forth an alternative world, risk is inevitable. So we are called to risk ourselves for the sake of Christ in propagating the gospel of Christ. I would like to bring forth three different perspectives with regard to the gospel text that was read to us. Firstly, this text is always read from the perspective of consumerism, where the one who earned is given more. And people celebrate this because God has given me more and more. I was truthful to this Lord, so God has given me more and more. It is merely a consumeristic perspective. The one who was given 5 talents earns 5 more and he is given more. The one who was given 2 talents earns more and he is given more. And the one who was given 1 talent, he keeps it for self. So here, earning more and more is taught as gospel to people. And today, prosperity theology is justified with this parable. But if we read this text in a deeper way, I think it breaks the shackle of this understanding. Luke chapter 18 and 19 bring forth three parables. The first parable is about the young rich ruler who says that he's been keeping the commandments from his childhood. And then Jesus tells him, you lack something. In spite of you keeping the commandment from your childhood, you have accumulated wealth. Therefore, you have to share your wealth. That is what you lack in yourself. And the second parable or the second teaching is about Zacchaeus. Though Zacchaeus challenges Jesus, you just let me know if I have cheated anyone, I will pay them fourfold. He is challenging Jesus, which shows that Zacchaeus would have earned his money with truthfulness. However, Jesus tells him, I know that you have earned it, but the salvation begins here when you share what you have earned. So having these two parables or having these two stories in Luke 18 and 19, when they were listening to them, that is how the text starts, verse 11 starts. When they were listening to them, he started to tell this parable. Who were they? It is the community who were in the context of Zacchaeus' story. So how could Jesus bring forth a parable of accumulation again here and justify that the one who earned more is the one who followed the commandment? I leave this for the congregation to ponder upon. Secondly, this parable is also thought as a counter to capitalism. Capitalism is something which encourages to earn more in exploiting the labor of the people. So the text says the owner is the one who wants to make money out of everything. And then this owner goes to come back again with more power. So the one who comes with more power will always yearn for more money. So the one who is yearning for more money will always co-opt others. So here, the owner who goes out to claim power comes back with more power, and he recognizes the one who made more money, and he acknowledges him. That is what the capitalistic nature is all about. Claiming more, be it power or money. And we always try to link that owner to Jesus, but I don't think so. That person could be linked to Jesus when we view this parable from the eyes of capitalism. So I leave it to the congregation again to think deeper in this aspect. I would like to bring forth the third perspective, which is evangelistic in nature. I read this as a parable which encourages evangelism. And evangelism involves risk. So a person who engaged in the mission to multiply the talent, it is nothing but he has engaged in multiple risks in order to propagate the values of Jesus. So, dear friends, stewards are called to engage in risks, risking the self in order to bring forth the values of Jesus. So, as stewards, we are called to be a community of liberality. We are called to be a community that is convinced and content. We are called to be a community that is commissioned with commitment of risking the self in order to propagate the gospel values of Jesus. May the good Lord continue to bless us and encourage us to be part of this stewardship. Transparency is the transcendent God becoming immanent. God who was invisible became visible in and through the life of Jesus. And accountability was disclosed on cross in liberating the world, in risking the life in order to bring forth a new world. As stewards, may the good Lord encourage us. May the good Lord encourage us to be transparent as Jesus and to be accountable as the cross has called us to be. May God bless you all. Thank you.
With gratitude to God for all the profound theological insights and invitation to each one of us to be good stewards, transparent and accountable in all our resources entrusted to us, I thank our civil area chairman, Reverend Christy Gnanadasan, for ministering to us. In response to the message from the Word of God, shall we affirm our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Church announcements. Dear sisters and brothers in Christ, thank you for joining our online worship service. Due to government restrictions for public gathering, because of COVID second wave, our worship services through physical presence have been cancelled. For your benefit, the short order of our Holy Communion worship service will be streamlined at 7 a.m. every Sunday. Our Cathedral YouTube link will be shared, and our Sunday worship service can be viewed anytime at your convenience. Please kindly attend our online worship service and be blessed. Due to government restrictions for public gathering, no marriage, baptism, Holy Communion, funeral services, or any other services will be conducted inside the cathedral. Sunday school announcements. The Sunday school has been reopened virtually from 20th June for the academic year 21-22. The classes will be conducted over video conferencing platforms, the details of which have been communicated by the teachers for their respective classes. Parents and caregivers are requested to encourage the children to join our Sunday school for their spiritual growth and leadership skills development. A new section for young adults has been added to the Sunday school as a bridge between Sunday school and youth fellowship. The purpose is to provide spiritual guidance for children who have graduated from the 12th and not yet completed their undergraduate programs. The new section of young adults will be facilitated by the Sunday school along with the youth fellowship to provide help for their spiritual growth and nurture. Those children who are not yet part of the Sunday school are requested to register at the link provided on our website. For any clarifications on the above, you may contact Mrs. Lena Prabhukumar at 98451-30188. Her contact details are furnished on our website. The pastorate committee election for the triennium 21-24. The pastorate committee, in its meeting held on 23rd June 2021, has decided to conduct the election to the Pastorate Committee for the Triennium 2021-2024 on Sunday, 25th July 2021, provided the government lifts the weekend curfew. The final voters list is displayed on the notice board and has also been uploaded on our Cathedral website. On the election day, that is Sunday, 25th July, the time of voting in the mini hall will be 8:30 a.m. to 2 p.m. The calendar of events, along with the qualification for the voters and candidates, is furnished on the Cathedral notice board as well as on the Cathedral website. The members of the congregation are requested to visit the Cathedral website for the update on the Pastorate Committee election. Operation Good Samaritan Project Phase 2. On 19th June 2021, the team comprising of Presbyter in Charge, Reverend Dr. Vincent Vinod Kumar, Mr. David Pichamuthu, and Mr. Suresh Simon organized Round 4, Phase 2 of Operation Good Samaritan. In this round, the team visited Sevanagar and distributed 150 grocery kits to the COVID frontline warriors and to the poor and needy in that ward. The Operation Good Samaritan team is grateful for the prayers and financial support of the congregation members toward this noble cause. Recruitment of assistant secretaries at YMCA. The YMCA is recruiting young Christian boys who have completed the degree for the post of assistant secretaries to work at the YMCA. For more information, please kindly see the Cathedral notice board or its website. The list of names of those who are celebrating their birthday or wedding anniversary during this week is furnished on our website. Please kindly update yourself and wish all those who are celebrating their very special day, please wish them. At this time, let us invoke God's blessings upon them.
Birthday and wedding anniversary wishes. Let us pray. Gracious God, we are grateful to you for giving us the privilege to invoke your blessings on all those who are celebrating their birthday or wedding anniversary today or during this week. Lord, grant to them every blessings and the gifts of faith to guide them throughout the new year. They will begin in your name. Make their birthday or wedding anniversary one of the blessings, joy, peace, and love that satisfies their soul. Continue to be their strength and stay in time of difficulty. Help them to be witnesses to your wonderful work in their life. Fill them with love. Bestow your rich blessings on them that they will have many more birthdays or happy anniversaries. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Intercessory prayers. Your response after every bidding shall be, hear our prayer. We pray for your church in this world that it may be obedient to your will and strong in your spirit to show your love and glory to all people. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our country and for all countries that people may live in peace with justice and honor. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all the COVID infected patients who are battling for life. May your healing virtue flow through them and restore them to good health. We also remember the officials of the helm the police office, the social workers, the others who are engaging in constantly serving the community, risking their own safety. May this virtue weaken and stop the spreading. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those families that have lost their dear ones to the virus. Comfort and console them in their hour of grief. We also pray for those most vulnerable to this infection, owing to age and pre-existing medical conditions. Protect them and keep them safe from all harm and danger. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those people belonging to the poorer section of the society, those who have lost their jobs and left with no resource of their sustenance. Help them in this moment of severe financial crisis. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We especially pray for our children who are suffering without proper schooling and mentoring because of the COVID-19 pandemic. Help them as they attend online classes. Grant to them your wisdom and knowledge and enable them to pursue excellence. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Let us all pray together in unison. Lord, though we do not know what the future holds for us, we do know that you are the one who holds our future. Help us put our faith on you and enable us to live in peace and joy, your gift of life. Safeguarding this beautiful earth entrusted to our care. In Jesus' matchless name we pray. Amen. Let us receive the blessings in faith. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance on you and give you peace. Amen.
Let us commune with God through the breaking of the bread. How very good and pleasant it is when people of God live together in unity. We who are many are one body, for we all partake of the one bread. Now I will offer in a stand sacrifices with shouts of joy. I will sing and make melody to the Lord. Let us offer to one another the sign of peace through namaskar and say to one another, the peace of the Lord be with you. The peace of the Lord be with you and also with you. Now, as we sing the offertory hymn, let us offer our thank offering to God. Members can either do online payment to church bank account or set apart their tithes and offerings and pay to the church office and obtain a receipt. The church QR code and the bank details will be projected on the screen. Our offertory hymn is, I'm thine, O Lord, I have heard thy voice.
present these offerings with them ourselves for the service of the Divine Majesty. Let us pray. O Father, you have given us a new and living way to offer ourselves to you. Though unworthy, we come to you as we are. By that way, your Son, Jesus of Nazareth, and in his name, we ask you to accept and use us and these gifts, however it best pleases you. All that is created is yours, and everything that we can offer already belongs to you. Amen.
Rejoicing in the presence of our Lord Jesus Christ amidst us, shall we all in unison say the prayer of presence? Be present, O Jesus, you good high priest, as you were in the midst of your disciples, and make yourself known to us in the breaking of the bread, who lives and reigns with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, world without end. Amen. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give God thanks and praise. Truly it is right and good to glorify you at all times and in all places. We are offering you our thanksgiving, O Lord, Holy Father. You spoke and the light shattered darkness. Order arose from confusion. You breathed into the dust of the earth and we were formed in your image. Through your Son, our Lord Jesus, you came to us while we wandered. He met us as a refugee, a threatened child. He called us by name to leave what is comfortable to be his disciples, friends and partners. With his outstretched arms on the cross and through his death, he bore our sins, and through his resurrection, we are saved. And to your Holy Spirit, you brood over chaos that we create, mothering us and shaping a new creation. You enlighten everyone coming to the world. You inspire the prophets and the apostles to find the right word at the right time. You liberate, equip, and commission your people for the continuance of your mission to make everything new. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim and sing your glory. Holy, holy, holy. Lord God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." The same way after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me." Lord, we commemorate your death on the cross, we celebrate your resurrection, and we await your coming. Eternal God, let your Holy Spirit move in power over us, over these earthly gifts of bread and wine, that they may be the communion of the body and blood of Christ, and that we may become one in him. May his coming in glory find us ever watchful in prayer, strong in truth and love, faithful in the breaking of the bread. Then at last, all peoples will be free, all divisions healed, and with your whole creation, we will sing your praise through your Son, Jesus Christ, through Christ, with Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. All glory and honor are yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. Amen. As our Savior Christ has taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. With true penitent heart, shall we all say the prayer of humble access. We do not presume to come to this your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs on your table, but you are the same Lord whose nature is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies and souls may be made clean by his most precious body and blood, that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us. Amen. Now, when the bread and the cup is lifted, I request the head of the family to lift the bread and the cup. When we break the bread, do we not share in the body of Christ? We seek to share your life, gracious God. When we lift the cup, do we not share in the lifeblood of Christ? We seek to share your life, gracious God. Shall we all prayerfully sing, O Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. As a family, you can partake in the bread and the wine. Having now by faith received the sacrament of the body and blood of Christ, let us give thanks. Let us follow the litany of thanksgiving. Merciful God of all creation, Holy Father of all people, through our Lord Jesus Christ, who united all things in his fullness, we join your whole creation in excellent praise of your bountiful goodness. You have now touched us with new life and filled us with new hope, that your rain will come, that the hungry will be fed, that the oppressed will be set free from evil, that a reconciling work will be done, that love and faithfulness be together, that justice and peace will kiss each other, and the whole creation filled with your glory. Amen. Blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be unto God forever and ever. Amen. Our closing hymn is, Down in the valley with my Savior I would go.
Down.
Let us receive God's blessings in faith. The peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of His Son, Jesus Christ, O Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always.